Humanity is facing a crisis. If we continue on our current path of overconsumption of products and services, Earth will run out of resources, thousands of species will be driven to extinction, and our planet's climate will be dramatically altered. So, how do we prevent devastation from occurring? How do we meet the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs? As we saw in our previous video, it's evident that improving a product's environmental footprint or eco-efficiency is not enough to solve the problem. We need to move away from the idea of trading off the three interacting dimensions, that is, the environment, the economy, and society. This triple bottom line approach will not address the sustainability crisis. Therefore, our concept of sustainability needs to change from relative to absolute. Understanding the drivers of impact. Environmental impact, or I, can be represented mathematically as a function of population, affluence, and technology. In the field of sustainability, this is known as the IPAT equation. That is, I equals P times A times T. An engineer's involvement falls within the domain of developing technologies. However, as we've already seen, improvements made in the technology area may be wiped out because of the population growth and the associated affluence growth. In addition, it's well known that affluence and technology are coupled, meaning the eco-efficient technologies we have developed have led to us using them in greater numbers and larger physical sizes, as we previously saw in the examples of LED lights and LCD TVs. Therefore, there's a need for a stronger definition of sustainability, one that respects the planetary boundaries and other species on Earth. This can be achieved by using a sustainability model in which our society and its economy are nested inside Earth's life support system. The role of engineers. We need to understand the challenge ahead of us. To begin with, the United Nations sustainability goals have been introduced as a target. We also need to understand the magnitude of the challenge. First, let's revisit the IPAT equation and rewrite it as impact equals population, the number of people, multiplied by affluence, the number of products per person, multiplied by technology, the environmental impact per product. According to the UN, the world's population is predicted to reach 11.2 billion in the year 2100 and will level off shortly thereafter. Material standards of living will grow strongly in newly industrialized countries such as China and India. However, environmental impact has already exceeded sustainable levels in many dimensions such as greenhouse gas emissions. So, what exactly is the challenge? It turns out that in order to counterbalance the expected growth in population and affluence, the technology factor, or environmental impact per product, must decrease by a factor of up to 20. Life cycle engineering. We need a new engineering paradigm, or to develop new products and product technologies. Hence, life cycle engineering, or LCE, a set of sustainability-oriented product development activities within the scope of one to several product life cycles. The aim of these activities is to achieve sustainable manufacturing in order to fulfill the needs of both present and future generations without exceeding the boundaries of Earth's life support systems. A product's life cycle concerns everything from its design, manufacturing process, after-sales usage, and end of life. In order to initiate life cycle engineering, a framework is first introduced. The main aim of the framework is to position life cycle engineering in relation to sustainability and other disciplines. The framework has two main dimensions, namely the scope of environmental concern and the scope of temporal concern, represented on the Y and X axes respectively. Sustainable development can be represented in this graph as an overarching platform with a focus on societies on the environmental scale and human generations on the temporal scale. For instance, Industrial ecology as a discipline can be represented in this graph within the scope of economies and human generations. In this context, concepts such as the circular economy and industrial symbiosis are also represented at this level. However, these are all top-down concepts, and although they are relevant, it's not the core function of what industrial organizations do as part of their operations. Below industrial ecology is life cycle management, a bottom-up approach which encompasses the scope of one company and a generation of products. Life cycle management is a business management approach that can be used by all types of businesses and organizations to improve their products and services, and thus the sustainability performance of the companies and associated value chains. Similar to life cycle management, life cycle engineering is a bottom-up approach. As a function of an industrial organization, it sits in the middle of the framework with the scope of environmental concern of one or multiple products on the y-axis and the scope of temporal concern of one or multiple products on the x-axis. Life cycle engineering allows us to develop products and services by taking into account volume growth and technology changes in order to systematically reduce their environmental impact along each stage of their life cycle. This ensures that any problems concerning environmental sustainability do not shift from one life cycle stage to another. Life cycle engineering promotes a long-term solution by addressing the sustainability problems at their root cause. This is particularly important during the designing of a product where up to 80% of its environmental footprint is determined. By using the tools of life cycle engineering, we can identify areas for improvement in the product's life cycle and ultimately develop environmentally sustainable products. The most common life cycle engineering tools and techniques include eco-design, life cycle assessment, life cycle costing, and material flow cost accounting. Such tools allow for the quantification of the environmental impacts of products and their associated costs in order to identify the highest improvement potential along the product life cycle, also known as hotspots. For example, if a product's main footprint is during the manufacturing phase as a result of excessive energy consumption, the same product can be re-engineered by developing alternative manufacturing processes that require less energy input, thus reducing the product's associated environmental impact. But what is the role of life cycle engineering in the use phase after a product has been designed and manufactured? By employing tools such as eco-labeling and eco-profiling, customers can be encouraged to buy more environmentally friendly products or minimize their energy and water consumption after purchase. Finally, at the end of their life cycle, products need to be managed in an environmentally friendly manner. For this to happen, products need to be designed with an end-of-life view. Therefore, life cycle engineering tries to develop products that are easy to collect, separate, reuse, remanufacture, and recycle in order to reduce the number that end up in landfill. Is this the solution to our problems? On its own, life cycle engineering isn't enough to solve the sustainability crisis. However, when applied within the sustainability framework, which takes into account the planetary boundaries, we can develop more sustainable products and services that allow us to meet the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. So, as you complete your studies and start your careers, keep in mind the role you will play in the IPAT equation. And always remember this, there is no Planet B. This video series was supported by UNSW Sydney's Inspired Learning Initiative and produced by Dr. James Vassie with the engineering advice of Professor Sami and Dr. Shiva Abdoli.